grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the Son of David. Let us pray. Most merciful God, as the people of Jerusalem with palms in their hands gathered to greet your dearly beloved Son when he came into his holy city, grant that we may ever hail him as our King, and when he comes again, may go forth to meet him with trusting and steadfast hearts, and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took palms, branches of palm trees, and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your King is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, "You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us go forth in peace in the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
Almighty and everlasting God, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross. Mercifully grant that we may follow the example of his great humility and patience and be made partakers of his resurrection. For the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of the wild oxen. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of the wild oxen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. The Old Testament reading is from Zechariah chapter 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim, the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you hope. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will receive me to glory. Truly, God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. The epistle reading is from the second chapter of Philippians. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 27th chapter.
Glory
be to thee, O Lord. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." But all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole battalion before him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head, put a reed in his right hand, and kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him, and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. And as they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. When they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. And they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, "This man is calling Elijah." And one of them at once ran and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." And he cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs were also opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to men. When the centurion and those who were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. We confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come celebrations. One joyful and the other is somber, ominous. One is Palm Sunday and the celebration of the people because God's fulfilled promise of the Messianic King coming to reign over his people. This is a day filled with praise and hosannas. The people wanted salvation and God was delivering it in the person of his son, Jesus. But most of today is not linked with that feat. Instead, after a short moment of joy this morning, we switch gears into the mournful repentance of the passion of the Christ and the suffering of Holy Week. There will be more services this week, and their focus will continue to be on all that Jesus does to be our Savior and to pay for the sins of the world. Jesus riding into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday was in fulfillment of the prophet Zechariah. God's deliverance wouldn't come to his people through a military, a powerful warrior king, but God told Zechariah that salvation would come and the king would be riding humble and lowly on the foal of a donkey. That's the very opposite of a conquering hero, and yet this is how God brought salvation into the world and showed his people that their Savior has come. It's also reminiscent of Jesus coming into the world as he's born of the Virgin Mary in the humble surroundings in Bethlehem. Jesus even borrows the donkey that he rides. But the people understand the message that Jesus is sending to them. He is the fulfillment of God's promises to David and to all the generations in between. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. But the shouts of praise in Jerusalem quickly turn to shouts of crucify him. Not as quickly as we did today in our service, but it still happened during 1 week. Those who followed and supported Jesus quickly turned away from him too. Judas betrayed him. Peter denied him 3 times, and all the disciples ran away from Jesus in the garden that night. Just when God's plan of salvation was coming together, it appears to human eyes that it's all falling apart. It's the time for darkness to reign over the light. Evil, injustice, wicked conniving seem to have all taken the place of peace, justice, and righteousness. To have Pilate declare Jesus' innocence and yet hand him over to the executioners is baffling. How could the governor do such a thing? That's not justice. Surely if the emperor found out, he would be removed from office for such a miscarriage of justice. But how often does this still happen in our world today? The righteous are persecuted. The guilty go free. Those in power use their influence to benefit themselves, and those without power can do nothing about it. The soldiers, they not only beat Jesus severely with their fists, but the scourging that preceded a crucifixion was no light punishment. It was almost an art form to inflict as much pain as possible without causing death. This is what Jesus received, and Barabbas, the one who was an insurrectionist and a murderer, who was condemned to die, he goes free. The innocent is condemned. The guilty goes free. This is what the chief priest wanted. Well, maybe not exactly what they wanted, but if it meant that they would be free of Jesus, then their lives could go back to normal. Or so they thought. How many times have we gone from faithfully following Jesus to denying that we even know him or go to church? Certainly not us. We're trying to figure out how to have Easter celebrations from home next week. It won't be the same, but it will be okay. My prayer is that when this isolation and distancing is over, we can gather together again, that there will be large groups of believers and those wanting to know more about Christ gathering in each and every church. We should not be shy about claiming Jesus as our Lord and Savior anymore, because none of us knows how much time we have left on this earth. What we do know is that our time on earth will end. And when that happens, we had better be prepared to stand before God and face His judgment. We are sinners. In our thoughts, words, and deeds, we've been like the disciples. We've been like Peter. We've voiced our faithfulness to Christ at our confirmation, but we've also shown by our words and actions that we fail to always confess and not deny our faith in Jesus. The temptation of Satan and the pressures of this world override our faith at times. And our mind causes our mouths to say words that we later regret. We, like Peter, need the forgiveness of Jesus, which He freely gives to sinners. As Jesus hangs on the cross, He forgives those around Him who are taunting and ridiculing Him. The innocent one speaks kind words to those guilty of condemning and blaspheming Him. He takes all their abuse, even the temptation to come down from the cross because they say they'll believe in Him if He can do that. But He knows that the only way for them to truly believe and be saved is for Him to stay on that cross to His dying breath. This is the way that Jesus leaves behind this mortal life to return to heavenly glory through the suffering and death that comes to Him on the cross. Because of Jesus' sacrifice for us, we too one day will leave this decaying, wretched existence and through faith enter triumphantly into that glorious eternal life beyond. The only miracle left for Jesus to perform was to raise Himself from the dead. And that's the reality of this day and this week as well. As somber and sober as we are through Holy Thursday and Good Friday, we know that on Sunday morning, Jesus will rise and the tomb will be empty. Even in our sorrow over our sin, we know that forgiveness has been won for us by Christ. But just because we know there is forgiveness does not mean that we should make Christ's payment for our sins something cheap, something meaningless. His suffering for our sins was a harsh punishment that He endured so that we do not have to suffer eternally. He lives, and we shall live also. And nothing shall separate us from the love of God that is in and through Christ Jesus. Shout Hosanna to Jesus. Save us from this hour and from this sin-sick world. Save us from our self-pity and sorrow by showing us what real suffering is as all your friends abandoned you, denied you, and betrayed you. All that we go through is really nothing compared to all the sins that you have borne for the salvation of the world. We would be lost eternally. We feel lost right now, not being in church when we desire it so much. We can still taste the host and the wine on our tongues as your supper is celebrated, but we don't have it right now. It's withheld, not because of our sin, but because of the weakness of our flesh. A day will come for us soon, and we will gather again. And it should be with shouts of thanksgiving and praise to our God for bringing us through this time of separation and trial. He does it for our own good, to help us grow in our own personal and family devotions with God during this time. firmly to Christ alone. Amen. Now may the peace that passes all our understanding keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. We sing together the offertory.
Trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.